probably will need a little instruction here as to how to move the slides forward, so that's okay. I'm not quite at that point yet. Do want to say a word or two about the Tacoma Historical Society. We're very, very pleased, those of us who are members, to open up a Tacoma History Museum in downtown Tacoma. Now, a Tacoma History Museum, not the Washington State Historical Society Museum, which, by the way, is great, but we get confused a bit with the Washington State History Museum. We're at 919 Pacific Avenue, and we're open from Wednesday through Saturday from 11 to 4, no admission charge, but we, of course, gladly accept donations at the door. I might note that we've actually published two books. I just want to make mention of this, because if you've got kids or grandkids or nephews or nieces that you think should know something about the city of Tacoma, they're in elementary school or thereabouts, these two books might be of interest to you. The one is entitled Tacoma's 21 Tales Every Student Should Be Able to Tell. It involves 21 people, places, or things that kind of characterize and define the city of destiny. And it's an interesting book that you can put in a stocking. And then another one around Christmas time, if you wish. The second one that we put up, Rising Up from Tacoma's 21 Disasters and Defeats. And, of course, there's a picture of Galloping Gertie on the cover, as you can well imagine. That was one of our interesting experiences. But these 21 disasters and defeats were selected by a group of students, actually, that went from Seabury School that went to the Tacoma Public Library Northwest Room and did some research and determined as to which those 21 disasters and defeats. And of course, we say rising up from, because the lessons that are learned from looking at these as to how we coped and adjusted and made things right after experiencing those episodes. So this morning I'm going to talk about the cleanup of the Prevention of Bay and the Foss Waterway. You know, it's fitting and proper that here I am in a building right on Commencement Bay. That's kind of neat. Timing is everything. It's a little early morning for me.
Location.
Thank you so much. It was 35 years ago that Tacoma made the front pages once again of the New York Times. Now, I'd like to think that on occasion we make the front pages of the New York Times for a positive reason, but 35 years ago it was not a very positive story on the front page of the New York Times. And actually, I have a copy of that article, a wee bit from it. It said, Tacoma's pollution on 10 worst list. The lead of the article, again, this is Tacoma, Washington, November 5th, 1981. The Federal Environmental Protection Agency's recent listing of Tacoma's Commencement Bay as one of the 10 worst toxic waste sites in the country was greeted with surprise here in Tacoma. People were aware, however, that scientists had discovered liver cancer and other diseases in bottom fish in the bay, and the public health authorities had cautioned against eating the fish. Now, if you've been around a while, you probably remember that. Front page, and I still remember the front page article, the News Tribune, with the photo of the fish with lesions on it. And then a quote, Tacoma may be living on a marine garbage dump. Dan Thayer, a fish biologist, said last year, last January, the Tacoma Pierce County Health Department warned people not to eat fish or shellfish caught in the heavily polluted waterways. Still, even employees of the health department were surprised when on October 23rd, the Environmental Protection Agency issued a list of the 114 hazardous waste sites and listed Commencement Bay among the worst 10. The mayor at the time referred to it as a political stunt. It was no political stunt. In fact, Tacoma was listed with Love Canal. This Commencement Bay was listed with Love Canal as one of the 10 worst toxic waste sites in the country. Now, we've come a long way, haven't we? Think about that for a moment. Just think about the significance of that. One of the 10 worst toxic waste sites in the country. And of course, that included our ASARCO site. It's not far from here. In 1983, ASARCO shut down, finally. And then 10 years later, the stack came tumbling down. The Foss Waterway was considered the most polluted inland waterway in the United States of America. It was so polluted that barnacles couldn't grow on pilings. You didn't want to swim, certainly. You didn't want to drop into the Foss Waterway. It was a disaster. And there were people at that time that were kind of threw up their hands and said, gee, we can't really do much about that. You know, I mean, how on God's earth can we clean this up, this entire bay? 13 Superfund sites were listed. 13 hotspots were listed shortly after 1981. 1983, 13 were listed. And just think for a moment, the Asarco site. Just think about that. By the way, I worked there for 4 summers. Earning money so I could pay tuition at the University of Puget Sound. I knew that site well. My dad worked there for over 30 years and died of lung cancer, as it turns out. He had other bad habits, but that certainly contributed to his early death at the age of 55. So this is where we were 35 years ago. And that's where the Foss Waterway was at the same time, some 35 years ago. 10 years ago, we celebrated, it was 10 years ago, that the city of Tacoma finally completed the most ambitious environmental challenge it ever faced, and that was the cleanup of the Foss Waterway. Most ambitious. That was one of many challenges throughout this area. You know, actually, we can really applaud ourselves when you think about it. Back during that period of time also, let me say that Tacoma was really struggling on a side note in Lower Pacific. When I first started as a council member in 1992, I had a meeting in the Association of Washington Cities in Wenatchee. I was a newbie, and I had my little name tag on. They had a kind of a meet and greet, and a person from Yakima came up and shook hands and looked at my name tag and said, Bill Barr's from the city of Tacoma. Oh, Bill, do you still have to duck bullets when you drive through downtown Tacoma? I still remember, I'll never forget that till the day I die. Never forget that comment. That left a lasting impression with me. And of course, back in those days on Lower Pacific, the police department told me when I became a council member that the primary enterprise when it got dark on Lower Pacific was the sale of black tar heroin and prostitution. So that's where we were. That's where we were. And we have come a long way. We have a lot to be proud of. A lot to be proud of. Over $1 billion in investment to clean up Commencement Bay, and another $1 billion in investment to transform that part of downtown Tacoma just during that 35-year period. The most transformative period, I would say, in Tacoma's history, I would submit, given where we started back in 1981 in the 90s as to where we are today. I mean, it is pretty darn extraordinary. As a Tacoma guy, born and raised, couldn't be happier. Product of Tacoma's school system, Tacoma General Hospital, couldn't be happier, couldn't be happier. Anyway, so let's kind of go back in history here a bit about the Foss Waterway. We'll focus on that, how that all came to be. The railroad arrived here in 1873, the Northern Pacific. You know that the Northern Pacific was the second transcontinental railroad, and it was, of course, the franchise. The franchise was granted by Abraham Lincoln. Henry Morgan defined that as the greatest land giveaway in the country's history. And the railroad came out from Minnesota and arrived here, well, kind of in a circuitous way in 1873. And Tacoma was selected for a lot of reasons, primarily because the land, much of it could be taken from the Indians, by the way, by the railroad. And it was also, of course, they had this tremendous asset, this deep water port that the railroad could see. And it didn't have to, and it had to get to the salt water. The railroad had to get to the salt water by the end of December of 1873, or it loses its franchise, and it was struggling to get there. And it turns out that we were 35 miles further to the south of the big city to the north, Seattle, who really wanted it, wanted the terminus of the rail line to be there. And then, of course, Steilacoom was also competing for it as well. But Tacoma was granted, actually, Commencement Bay was the end point. Wasn't actually the city of Tacoma, it was Commencement Bay. As Rick Carr will point out, that the city of Tacoma was a little to the south of where the railroad ended up, and then the railroad built a second city called New Tacoma, and eventually in 1884, the two cities consolidated into one. But they had to also, they also create a facility for the ships to come in, and there was kind of a mantra of the rail line, the railroad back then. It was kind of a dredge and fill, dredge and fill. And so they created this waterway where the Puyallup River came in. Of course, you know, it's a river delta. And they started filling up the delta, and they built a line across the delta to the coal fields in Carbonado and Wilkeson. They also dug this waterway, the city waterway, where they could actually bring in ships, export and import. I might add just a little aside, the city of Tacoma was the key import center of the West. We had many ships from China and Japan that came in into Commencement, bring tea, silk, and other products from the Far East. So you have on your table an image. I want to talk a little bit about that. This I have some show and tell here. And this is this image is and you can kind of pass that around a little bit. This is a image that's on your table. And this image is a rendering of the Tacoma Hotel, which was built in 1884 by the Northern Pacific Railroad. And it was the grandest hotel north of San Francisco. Grandest hotel north of San Francisco. It was located where the Russell/State Farm building that now sits on A Street. That's where it was built. And it was a remarkable building. If you notice, and it was a way in which Tacoma could kind of sell itself as the boomiest of the boom towns, where people could come to the city destiny and visit and stay at the grandest hotel north of San Francisco, kind of comparable to the Empress in Victoria. And many famous people came, Mark Twain, Rudyard Kipling, Sarah Bernhardt, Babe Ruth, many presidents-to-be came and stayed at the Grand Tacoma Hotel. And you notice that below this rendering, and it was a way in which, you know, the city was trying to market itself and sell itself. You notice that below the Grand Tacoma Hotel, there's an esplanade along the water's edge. You notice that? And there kind of was a sailboat and a motor launch and a kind of a boathouse there. And there is kind of little looks like public art. It's kind of like what we see today along the Foss Waterway. You know, it's kind of a grand vision of what they were trying to sell Tacoma to be. But we know that this is a misrepresentation, really, a total misrepresentation, because you know where the Russell Building is, and you know there's a drop-off of about 75 feet. There's no sloping hill down to the waterway. And furthermore, if someone tried to walk from the Tacoma Hotel, they would fall down onto the railroad tracks because there was no esplanade along the water's edge. As a matter of fact, I have another show and tell. As a matter of fact, what was really along the water's edge around the turn of the century, this is kind of hard to see, but I'm just going to, and you'll have a chance maybe to come up and see it afterwards, but it turns out that along the water's edge from the original 11th Street Bridge, which is right here, all the way to the end of the Foss Waterway, was a mile-long covered warehouse dock. It was the longest dock in the world. It was a huge fence. There was no way you could get to the water's edge from the Tacoma Hotel, at least around the turn of the century. Absolutely impossible to get to the water's edge. There are two buildings still remaining, by the way, that was still that. By the way, it was the longest covered warehouse in the world, by the way. And they shipped out wheat and other grains. Tacoma was the wheat export center of the West at that time. And just, you know, tons and tons. In fact, they actually, and I have a photograph of it, they actually, there was folks there that actually invented the first conveyor belt that moved bags of wheat and dropped them into the ship where the people in the ship will actually catch those bags and stack them. They weighed over 100 pounds. They drop into the hold of the ship. So there was no way that you could get to it. It was cordoned off. And I might add that the folks, city fathers and mothers, were not particularly pleased with the fact that the railroad essentially sealed off the water's edge from not only the hotel, but from people in downtown. And so in the 1890s, there was an effort to convince the legislature to give the city the authority through some early version of eminent domain to seize or to procure part of that property to give people the opportunity to get to the water's edge. And the city failed in that regard. And then finally, and we'll start, let's see, we can kind of move the slides here. I don't know if, can anyone see those slides? Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's move to the first image. here. It's kind of an interesting image. So there was, and so fighting Angelo Fawcett, who was the mayor at the time, here we go, fighting Angelo Fawcett, who was the mayor at the time, really felt that there had to be a way to get to the water's edge. The city had to find some way to get there, get to the water's edge. And so through his efforts and negotiating with the railroad, they were able to actually buy one of the dock buildings and own the land under it and build what was called the municipal dock building. And now, here's what you can see. This is the Tacoma Hotel here, Grand Tacoma Hotel, which, by the way, burned down in October of 1935, sadly. Now, this is the municipal dock building, which is just below the Grand Tacoma Hotel. And the municipal dock building, again, was built by the city of Tacoma. And you can see the Mosquito Fleet, it was called, the ships that came in. And there'll be another image here that we'll see in a moment. And that was it was kind of the first effort. They had, you know, the city had grand plans. I might add, just to the left of the municipal dock building was the 11th Street Bridge, the first 11th Street Bridge, which was built in 1894. Then the second 11th Street Bridge, the current bridge, was built in 1913. Those two projects were extremely important in terms of the development of the city. In any event, there was a restaurant there. There was a quote smoking room, play area for kids, a locker so that you could secure your bags. If you wanted to go to Seattle, best way to get to Seattle, by the way, was by boat, by the Mosquito Fleet. It's difficult to get. If you want to get to Fashion Island, or even further north to Vancouver. Let's look at the next slide, and I want to kind of show you kind of an interesting series of slides here. How do I best do that?
Chris, which one is that? Hit the mouse button.
Okay, someone's going to have to
just click this.
Oh, that one. Okay,
okay, there, okay, okay, good. Okay, there you go. Zach, you go.
Okay, we're not.
Got it. Okay. Oh, look, back. Okay, we'll get back. I hope so we can get it back. Looks like we can. Okay,
then you can get it back.
We can get it back.
You just
got to get back to that. There we go. Okay, stop right there. Stop right there. Stop right there. Don't move. Stop right there. Okay. So this is, of course, the most famous totem pole, right? The world's tallest totem pole. It was erected in 1903. There's some interesting aspects about this this photograph that I want to share with you. To the left is the Tacoma Hotel, the Grand Tacoma Hotel, and there's some people standing at the bottom of the totem pole, and there's a sign there that says something. I can't read it. But in the back is a very interesting, this is kind of a portal or an entryway. This is an old, kind of around the turn of the century, probably about 1910, 1912. And people in the Tacoma Hotel then could buy tickets on the Mosquito Fleet to go to wherever they wanted to go, actually eventually to Alaska if they so desired, or to Seattle or Vancouver. Then they could buy tickets there. This again is on A Street, okay, in terms of, this is to, on this side is where they warehouse, or the Weyerhaeuser building is located. True Blue is located there now. And this is where the Russell/State Farm building is located. Okay, so we'll try the next one here and see what happens. Okay, now what you see here is the first pedestrian bridge connecting downtown to, again, the Tacoma Municipal Dock, which allowed people at the hotel or others to buy tickets, that place where I showed you in the last photograph, and then walk down this pedestrian overpass to the Municipal Dock building. It was kind of a long, sloping, rather ambitious, and I have other photos of it, of a walkway. Which was covered, and you could take your luggage on a cart and just push it down this pedestrian walkway to the Tacoma Municipal Dock. You could have dinner there, and catch the Mosquito Fleet to wherever you wanted to go. And it's interesting. There's another. I don't know if I have an image of that. Let's see what comes up next. Maybe I do. Ah, This is a little closer view, again, of the municipal dock. It's a little later. This is probably the 1920s. And you notice it says U.S. Immigration Service, which indicates that people were Canadians were coming down from Vancouver to visit the city of Tacoma. And again, you can see the Tacoma Hotel up here, Grand Tacoma Hotel. Right here is the fire station, right next door, right across the street. And it's another part of the Tacoma story because, as I mentioned to you, a fire started in the Tacoma Hotel in October of 1935. And despite the fact that the fire department was right across the street, they couldn't put it out. Another Tacoma story. But I will say this. About the fire. Once the fire started in the building, it was just about impossible to get it out. As a matter of fact, the firefighters decided that at that time, the number one goal was to get everybody out of the hotel. To save everybody in the hotel as it was burning. In fact, there are some photographs, I digressed a bit here, there's some photographs that you can see of the hotel fire and people actually tying sheets together and hanging them out the window and shimmying down the sheets. I kid you not, that's how many of them got out of the hotel. Anyway, but you can still see the hotel above there, and this is a little later. I might add that over time, through neglect, sad neglect, the municipal dock building kind of fell in disarray, and over time, interestingly enough, as a result of a number of fires that took place, much of the mile-long dock burned down or was torn down, and eventually we lost the municipal dock. The city didn't put a roof on it, and eventually after the earthquake in the 1990s, we had to take it down, and so now you just see an open space there right next to the Levin Street Bridge. Little side note, if you ever go to the Urban Waters Research Center across the Foss Waterway, you see that wonderful wood paneling. Next time you go, look for it. If you're visiting there, that you own it if you live in Tacoma, by the way. I might want to visit it. That wood paneling actually comes from the Tacoma Municipal Dock. You see it. So note it next time. It's pretty extraordinary. And there you can see the mosquito fleet coming in. Of course, a more modern freighter in the back unloading there at the dock. Now this is a good shot of what the Foss Waterway looked like back in the day, back in the 1950s. And back in those days, actually you can see by way, this is Elbers Mill, by the way, which still stands. It's the only, that and the two pieces of my long dock are the only buildings that remain from the early days of the Foss Waterway. Back in those days, and there's a coal tar plant, there's a cement factory there, there's a lumber mill, there's a power station. And back in those days, the idea was, look, we just dump everything into the city waterway, and the tide will take it out, and eventually it'll get to the ocean, right? That was the theory. Mm-hmm. We just dump everything in, and it'll be flushed out. And of course, it wasn't flushed out. It just accumulated. About 1 million cubic yards of the most toxic materials you can imagine accumulated over the years as a result of what you see there. And that's what it looked like back in the 1950s, 1940s, 1950s. Some of us don't remember it, but we're living during that period of time. We really weren't paying attention to it. The only time we'd ever, see it would be if we crossed the 11th Street Bridge. Then we might notice what was going on along the Foss, or if we worked down there, we certainly would know what was going on. That gives you an idea of what was happening at that time. And this is another image of it a little later. And you can see there, it's hard to see, but interestingly enough, there are three bridges across the city waterway, the 11th Street Bridge, and there were two railroad bridges. They were swing bridges with a pivot. They swung around.
This was the swing one.
Both of them swing bridges. And matter of fact, the original 11th Street Bridge was a swing bridge as well. It swung around, and it was very inadequate. But it did open up the tide flats to development. So that's kind of where we were. And in the 1980s, late 1980s, this group called the Executive Council for Greater Tacoma was made up of Tacoma moguls, people like George Russell and George Weyerhaeuser and Bill Phillip and others kind of were meeting and discussing how
they could move the city of destiny forward into something, and to deal with some of these environmental issues. And they saw, and it was very visionary. They saw the Foss Waterway as an area of opportunity, which is pretty hard to see that as the case may be. Along the western edge of the Foss Waterway, the land was owned, with the exception of the municipal dock property, all that land was owned by the railroad, Burlington Northern Railroad, in particular its subsidiary, Glacier Park. And it was a Superfund site, which meant it was a toxic waste site designated by the Environmental Protection Agency. And the railroad, and if you own a Superfund site, you have the obligation of cleaning up that site. Legally, you have to clean it up. That's essentially the law. But the railroad was, if you know anything about the railroad, they move slow. Really slow. They move freight fast, but in terms of making decisions and dealing with the railroad, it's a challenge. It really is a challenge. And so you had that 27-acre site of property on the left-hand side of the, on the west side of the Foss Waterway, just sitting there. Now, when I was a city council member in the early 1990s, that whole area was cordoned off, and there was fencing around that area. Almost all the area south of the 11th Street Murray Morgan Bridge was cordoned off, and there was skull and crossbones, you know, signs. And razor wire, and you couldn't actually step on the site because it was a Superfund site owned by the railroad. Nothing was going to happen in the foreseeable future. Nothing was going to happen. And so the idea was, okay, what do we do about that site? And the city policymakers, city manager Ray Corpus, Mayor Karen Vial, and the members of the city council, put together this big deal that involved the Metropolitan Park District. It was a multifaceted deal. But a key part of that deal was to actually purchase that Superfund site, a 27-acre Superfund site from the railroad. Now, the railroad said, we got a hell of a deal here for you. It's a great deal. Now, this property is really worth $10 a square feet. We'll sell a whole lot to you for $6 per square foot. Well, actually, no one was buying a Superfund site. In fact, people were giving them away. In fact, people were saying, buy it from us. We will not buy it from us. We will give it to you, and we'll pay you to take it, actually. So the whole notion of actually buying a Superfund site was beyond the pale. And there were a whole series of decisions that took place. I have articles about it, and I'll just kind of speak to them. It was a deal that involved the Metropolitan Park District. It was an interesting arrangement there because there was a provision in the city charter that said the city could not sell any of its waterfront property. So you cannot, if the city owns a piece of waterfront property, cannot sell it. Okay. So we have a problem here. If we want to actually develop this waterway, or remediate the site, we can't sell it if we own it. What if we buy it from the railroad? We own it. So what the hell do we do? That's an interesting kind of dilemma. Because we own the property, we can't sell it for development. But if we buy it, we own it. So they came up with a scheme that we will essentially transfer it to the park district as a trustee. They will become the trustee of the property. Then we can sell the property through the park district. Very interesting kind of relationship. And then, and a part of this grand deal was to actually provide funding so that the park district could build this facility up in Northeast Tacoma. Which we now see this facility they have up there for, you know, it's kind of like a Boys and Girls Club or like YWCA, but it's really
Center Norpoint.
Thank you. And it was actually owned by the Park District, and that was kind of part of this multifaceted deal that was worked out with the. Of course, it was an interesting situation because the city said, well, we have some state funds that we can use to purchase this, but we need to actually get a sense of what our challenges, our environmental challenges. And so they hired this so-called engineering firm, the Bison Engineering Firm, to do an actual evaluation of the cleanup costs of that site, that 27-acre site. And actually, the firm was doing business with the Burlington Northern, so it's an obvious conflict of interest, you know, really, when you think about it, why we would hire an outfit that was doing business for the Burlington Northern to give us an objective evaluation. Really questionable. And then they came up with that its analysis, and they said, well, we think that it would cost we think the environmental cleanup cost would be about around $700,000, maybe a little more than around $700,000, a little more than that. And someone from the Environmental Protection Agency said, well, they're really looking at guppies, and you perhaps have whales here. Really good whales, kind of defining the challenge, you know, that was before them. But, you know, they went ahead, and the city went ahead, inside levy, and purchased that 27-acre site for $6.8 million. There was some state funds involved, and we now secure the site. Now, once you secure a Superfund site, what does that mean? That means you're obligated to clean it up. When the city manager was asked that, he said, well, there may be some other personally responsible parties that we can identify. We don't know who they are, but there may be some others there we can identify that will essentially be involved in cleaning this up as well. Of course, another thing that environmental protection people were saying was, you know, they really haven't evaluated the impact of cleaning up the in-water pollution. You've just looked at the possibility of the uplands. You haven't really examined the in-water challenges. Turns out the million cubic yards of toxic crap that accumulated in the faucet, we really haven't looked at that. And no, they really didn't look at that. And as it turned out, in the end, it cost about $100 million to clean that up. And so that $600,000 estimate kind of ballooned up to over $100 million. Primarily, by the way, the city didn't foot that entire bill. There was federal and state funds involved as well in cleaning that up. And so what was the end game? You know, we had an event here in which we, Tacoma Historical Society, which we celebrated the cleanup at Point Ruston, right on the Grand Plaza. We put a big tent up, and we actually applauded. We had four of the policymakers there. We actually, Mayor Bial and three of the council members, Harold Moss and Tom Stinger and Paul Miller, we actually applauded them because in the end, even though very dubious and very questionable in terms of the decision that was made, in point of fact, it's doubtful the railroad would have done anything in the near future. Doubtful. It could have still been laying fallow to this very day if the city hadn't secured the property. And the railroad said, take it or leave it. We're not negotiating. This is our price. Take it or leave it. $6.8 million. This is it. And again, dealing with the railroad is extremely difficult. So what is the end game? What has happened as a result of that purchase? There is about $400 million of investment either on the waterway or in the pipeline. That's private sector investment. There's also a public sector investment, the Esplanade. A lot of federal and state money has come about as a result. So all of those projects that you see along the waterway, including Theus Park, which is on the, and the seaport restoration, and the dock building, and of course the Murray Morgan Bridge, and then points of the south, Theus Landing, the Esplanade, the Henry, the Albers Mill, the marinas, all on the west side. We've had some challenges dealing with the port. We've been very supportive in terms of in the past in terms of what we've tried to accomplish, but it's a heck of a lot. There's another $52 million project in the pipeline, and the hotels and other projects that are out there a little further in the future represent another about $100 million. So in the end, when all is said and done, the pipeline, all these developments come to pass. Well, let me give you this last very positive image. In the end, when all is said and done, there'll be probably close to about $500 to $600 million. Of private development along the waterway. That's the end result. Something we can be really, really proud of. I mean, it's kind of like making sausage. You know, you don't want to look at the ingredients. You don't want to look at those decisions and how they were made back in 1991, frankly. And I think the policymakers are probably a little embarrassed in a way in some of the details. But at the end game, this is what we have. And it's something really to be proud of. And of course, on the other side of Pacific Avenue, the University of Washington, Tacoma, and its development. is pretty extraordinary too, about $127 million, even more than that, fell to University of Washington. So it is really an exciting development. I might add just one final thing. What do we do with the crap once we, you know, dig it out? You know? Well, what do we do with it? And the original idea was to dump it in Commencement Bay and cover it.
Ooh,
terrible idea, terrible idea. And by the way, Bob Evans, who was a councilman, and I, we were really opposed to that idea. And then Simpson came to us and said, look, we got the St. Paul Waterway. We don't need it anymore. So why don't you build a berm across the St. Paul Waterway? We'll drain it. And you can dump all that crap right into the St. Paul Waterway, and we'll cover it with 6 feet of clean earth. And that will give us additional land to build some cogeneration plants, and it will take care of your crap problem. And you won't have to put it in Commencement Bay. So if you want to know where all the crap is, it really is crap. That's the best way to explain it. Probably much worse than crap. It's in the St. Paul Waterway, and it's buried and covered. By the way, an incredible project to move that over to the St. Paul Waterway. And then part of it at the end is covered, part on the right at the end of the waterway. So that's kind of the story of the Fossil Waterway. One of the greatest achievements any city could ever accomplish, by the way. That and the ASARCO. And I don't have time to talk about the ASARCO, but that was an incredible achievement. Michael Cohen, that's an incredible project as well. And they used the same template, by the way, that the Fossil Waterway was used. There's more to the story, but that kind of gives you an overview. And I'm happy